about this place. Maybe you haven't said this way a little bit differently, but just check it out in a few places before. The man who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. And yet, so many of us have heard these words quoted often, but do we really remember the context in which this was framed? The context was found in last week's message was up on the screen as the basis for the year that the Lord put on my heart, our church, our faith family, our faith community, and it's a stronger core. And so the context continues in our text today. Last week we talked about our inner being, I referred to our core being strengthened by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we got to a certain place in the church, and I felt like that was enough. That was right there and done, because I love you, and I know you can only read. Thank you so much. Amen. But the message ended with the question, it ended with a cliffhanger, which is why. Why is Paul praying so fervently that he ignores Jewish customs of praying like this, and he bowed before the Lord and got down low and prayed with passion that we would be strengthened in our inner core, in our inner being? Why was he doing that? Well, the why is found in the following verses, so we're going to pick up right where we left off last week. This might be considered by some a simplistic message, but I want to be obedient to the text and obedient to the Holy Spirit, but the Lord do what he wants us to pray. Amen. So I want you to turn your Bible to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17. In the SBOG app, it's already loaded for you, and that's just for the Bible screen online, however you participate in that. I want you to look at this, and we'll have a word for it. I'm going to read verses 17 to 21. Here's the why. Why are we being strengthened? Why is he praying for us to be strengthened in the inner man, in the inner core? So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. He wants us to understand something that surpasses knowledge. Can we just pause for a second? Doesn't that seem like a conundrum of sorts? Right? I'd like you to comprehend something that surpasses knowledge. That's the prayer for us. Now to him, here's the context. Is this possible for him? Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than we all can ask or think, according to the power at work within us as the Holy Spirit, to him be the glory of the church and of Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen. So this is for all of us. I see the last part. He's part of all of us. If you agree, then you're all of us. Come on, sir. So right now, I just want to begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this message that you've laid upon my heart. It may be simplistic. I don't think it's always so simple to live it out and walk it out. It may be easy to talk about. But can we do what Jesus said? Can we believe and receive and walk in it? And God, for that, I pray that in our inner life, that we would be strengthened. I know that people are going through various things right now, whether in person or online, and I pray for the next little bit that we would not think about those things, that we would free and liberate ourselves from the cares and concerns of everything around us, and for just a little while, God, can we just sit together and let the Word of God be something of the soul of us that would impact us all day, all week. So, when I began to think about this text, I came to a question and I came to a conclusion all at the same time. And the question is, well, stronger core in 24, but what's at the core of the core? What's at the core of the core? And what I found out was the answer is the love of God. At the core of our core is the love of God. To be strengthened in the inner being, and all the things that God wants me to share with you this year, and talk about being stronger at the core as a church, as individuals, as families, as a follower of Christ, but you've got to go to the core of the core first before you go any further. And it's kind of funny because it's not funny, but it's just, it's the revelation, but in love. The New Living Translation says it this way, then Christ will make his home in your heart. As you trust in him, your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And when I first got the word rooted, what that means is that you have a well-settled foundation. And I know that when you do foundation work, you do some digging, you do some surveying, you get everything really level, and then you bring in this thing that's kind of strange. It's a compactor. And I worked in construction a long time ago, a lifetime ago. I was a laborer, that's code for human corporate, and worked on kids for football. But anyway, every once in a while, we would put this thing, and it would be this heavy rotating device. And they were just compact, like we got one of the they were just compact, everything down. And then finally, they would pour. And then you would have a well, firmly established foundation, a well settled foundation. And the higher you want to go, the deeper that will get. God wants my foundation, the core of the core, to be well settled. And it's very well settled, a firmly settled foundation. The love of Jesus Christ. I just believe that. So today I want to talk to you about the love of God. I want us to have a stronger grace. I want us to have a stronger appreciation for God's love in our own lives. I think that we might be better able to reflect God's love and share God's love with a world that's so desperately needed. I'm convinced when I watch the news and when I talk to people in the community, what people don't need is they need to experience the love of Jesus Christ. They need to experience something that is authentic, that is true, something that goes to the core of who they are, and gives them peace. Just yesterday, we celebrated the life of Pope Pennington, and we heard, I read something from his family about how his peace found faith, and she started coming, I guess, from the 90s to our church, everything changed for her. Why? She found Christ, and when she found Christ, she found love, and when she found the love of Christ, she found peace, and that peace that God invaded her has disappeared, sustained her, even to the very end. And so, we want to talk about this. Verse 18 begins with these words, may be able to comprehend. So we may be able to comprehend what? With all the saints, what is the breadth, the length, the height, the depth, and to know the love of Christ, and to know Christ. But the word comprehend is interesting. And there's an obvious meaning and a less obvious meaning. The obvious meaning of the word comprehend is to understand something, to perceive something, to learn something, to comprehend it with your mind, with your intellect. But a less obvious meaning of this word in the original language means to lay hold of so as to make one's own, to obtain. Oh, come on. Further, another less obvious meaning is that he takes possession of it. So I can know about something. So how many of you know it's different to take possession of something? And to say, I have obtained and I have experienced, I can change. I know it's different. I love Jennifer, but that was the business brand. No, 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 I had to go into the secret. I can tell you a story about flying all the way to Philadelphia from London. I don't have time for that. Just pull my hands from my head. I'm telling you, you can't say this on the floor. I'll rise again. Now, it's one thing to know that, but to obtain a relationship that is rooted in love will be powerful enough to forgive you for what I was doing that night. So we got to, God, here's my prayer, Lord, that we would not just comprehend the love of God because it's the sad phrase is, I don't think it's on the stage of question, just looking kicked in. He says, maybe, what is it? Maybe you're able to comprehend what all the things, what is the width, what is the length, what is the depth, what is the height, but know the love of Christ is the path of my life, and you may feel with all the fullness of God. It's amazing sometimes how people want to feel with all the blessings of God and all the Holy Spirit of God. But then, well, the first thing they could do, it seems like their life is just making noises with the reason they don't because they don't have the fullness. We can't have the fullness of life. We start here at the core of the story. So, what I want to share with you first is the width. The width of God's love includes everyone. The width of God's love includes absolutely everybody. We know that this is John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes, somebody say, whoever believes, and it should not perish, but has everlasting life. So this is whoever thinks. The love of God is for everybody. And we say this so freely and so easily. But do we really comprehend it? Because there are some people in this world that have done some pretty despicable, disgusting, heinous things. So terrible, I won't even mention it. But God so loved the world. So whoever is believing should not perish. Well, I'm telling you, the width of God goes all the way to the tomb. It goes all the way to the Christ tomb. It goes all the way to your house, to my house. It goes to the school house, to my school. It goes to City Hall. It goes to DC. It goes. The width of His love is for everybody. 1 Timothy says this: God, our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth of God. So the width of God says it touches for everybody. It is for everybody, but it is that God wants everybody to get saved. Why not? He wants everybody, absolutely everybody, and there's a conjunction in there. I love it. It's not or, and there's always a better conjunction. It's not so the same word. I want everybody to get saved, that's what God said, and to know the truth. What's the truth? I believe in 1 John, Jesus said, I am the truth, the way, and the life. He wants them to know Him, and in Him you'll know truth. What is truth? Truth is love. Love is truth. It's God's love. Not the world, and not the romantic stuff, and not the superficial feelings, and not the Lifetime movies. God's what it is. Here we go. I want to talk to you about the length of God's love. The length of God's love goes all the way to the keys to Christ. 1 John chapter 4, verse 19, and the text says the following. God shows how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son and his sacrifice to take away. He said that he went all the way to the cross. He sent his Son, God sent his Son, to sacrifice. That is so, I don't think we can even begin to comprehend the depth of the meaning of that. But he went to the west and he goes to the incredible. 1 Peter 2:4 says, he personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. I try to tell you, God has gone through incredible ways to provide for us a pathway for deliverance. And sometimes what we need to get delivered from is ourselves. Because sometimes some things in us, like wisdom, sometimes things in us are besetting, sometimes things in us become roadblocks, and we experience the same negative stuff over and 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 over again. And God says, you don't have to live that way. You don't have to keep experiencing it. You can experience something new. And it's so amazing that he said, I'm going to go all the way to the cross to provide a way of deliverance for you. You don't have to keep making that same mistake over and over and over and over and over again. You don't have to raise your hands, but I bet if I asked you, you'd almost do it. How many of you would just, you know, kind of, you just do it. But how many of you ever prayed for God to forgive you something twice? Three times. Third thing, you lost track of how many questions. Somewhere in that journey, we got to appreciate what my kingdom went to. And we got to do that just to hold the weight of the Spirit. Do our part. In every sin, in every temptation, God said this way, he said the way this way, he got to build something. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and he's going to get it. There's always a consequence. You don't have to pray for a 100 the first time. You can live quickly in Jesus. He went all the way to cross. So you really have to keep the spirit of your sin, the grief, and the negative consequences. The sin that you have to go all the way there to commit God to live in you from the little sins to the largest thing you can think of.
I will be like
make a little more love? Who?
Here!
the Holy Spirit.
You've got to love it.
really great the moment they show up.
The one that knows everything, the one whose width was wide enough, the one whose length went all the way to you, the one whose depth went all the way to the great feet, the one whose things are high, whose love is that high here. He's praying for you, and as he's praying for you, we should have anticipated some going on in our look. We should be on the road. Right? Don't be like me on a road trip. And the past tells us that there is a plan to make the clock on 5 miles a day. Bless the Lord, I am not going to think about 74 anymore. I'm slowing down. I'm getting in the front. God, it's a kid. Huh? Man, I'm wondering before he can walk into that place, and I know exactly what I want. I want to see the songs with Dr. the Temple. I can't go free. The Lord, I don't know. Why is it that you're all right now? I'm sorry, just put them on Facebook. I'm not going to preach you. They were good. How can we can anticipate those things? We can expect those things. We got the author of presence all praying for us. And we need to pray together. It is worthy. We were reminded of his word, your proposal. Why aren't we getting over in the exit lane? Why aren't we slowing our roll? Why aren't we calming down? Why aren't we taking place for this? God will tell you, that's your next one. Woohoo! Yeah! All right, we're driving forever. That's what I wanted. Fancy, this is just a dream next to me. Come on! I'll tell you what you're worship God. You are praying and worship God like your exit sign is coming up, like your promise is from the Lord. Declare it and you believe it because you know there's a God in heaven who loves you. Well, goes all the way to the throne room of God, and there's a God in heaven who's praying for you. And you know what? He's praying for you to strengthen. He's praying for you to get your core. He's praying you might have the strength to come with him. You have to all of your own, you experience the love of God that will sustain you. Come on, somebody. I'm in the middle of the wilderness right now. We'll celebrate the victory all the way. Amen. I'm in a terrible place to die in a first. God's not going to tell you to take a dip. Take a dip and stop going out. Amen. Start praising him and bring him back to you. Amen. So, let me just. Let me just ask you a question. Where does God intend us to experience this world? experience the love of God for God's people to do. First, the Christ, also, in the fellowship of the church, which may have its false Christianity made be far from what they ought to be, but in the fellowship of the church, we still find the love of God. He's like, people, okay, so we do it to the saints. If you can see it too, but that strength is not for you. With all the saints. Not with all your cats and dogs and furniture at home. Not with your friends at Starbucks. Come on, somebody. Right here. And announce the Lord with all the saints. Oh, you should have asked, well, let's take a look at the text a little bit more. Verse 20, out of him, who is able to far more abundantly than all that we ask and think, towards the power at work within us, to him, the glory, where? In the church. And in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So, for all age groups, all demographics, and I know that we are the church, the building is the church, but the gathering of the saints is the church. And this is where we gather, and then we become disciples together, because we're not called to gather and scatter, we're called to gather and make disciples. And when you make disciples, you love God, and you love others, you serve God, and you serve others, you see that through the vehicle of the invention of the church. God invented the church as the only institution that God made to get his message out, and to save the world, and to heal the world, and to help the world. We're just the vehicle, that's it, we're the conduit. But this is where we're supposed to experience the love of God, and to fellowship and real. You're watching online right now, and I love you. And those of you, I'm so glad you're here, because you believe this place feels so lovely. And if you need that, I'm trusting you. The love of God is the only thing that is the most important thing. And as well, the same is the love of God. All the way to the best of the world. That's the love of God. I hope that we have 3 groups.